to your seat this morning. Go ahead and make your way back to your seat. So this morning, we are officially launching into the Christmas season here at Word of Life Church. And if you've noticed the big backdrop behind me for the last couple of weeks, our theme for December is Emmanuel, Proclaim the Name. And so what we're going to be doing over the next 4 weeks is talking about why it's so important for us as followers of Jesus to understand not only what Emmanuel means, but to make that name known amongst our friends, our family members, our coworkers, even strangers on the street. And so that's what we're going to do today. How many of you guys like to understand how things work? Anybody in here, one of those people? Yeah, you like to actually understand how something works. You don't just take it and think, okay, I'm going to put all of my faith in this. No, you actually want to be able to break it down and understand some of the parts. Some of you all are like me. I don't really care. As long as it works, I'm happy. But there's a lot of people that need to know why things are the way they are. So, this morning, we're going to do a little bit of a deeper dive into theology, okay? Now, I promise we're not going to get super boring. We're not going to get long-winded, 2 hours at most. It's going to be fun. It's going to be a good day. And the less you laugh and smile, the longer I will go, all right? That is a threat all day long. No, I want you to be able to walk out of here this morning and be able to explain to people what the actual meaning of Christmas is all about. All right? Just think about the term, Christmas. Christ is the central part of this season. That's why it's not named Rudolph or presents or chubby, happy, fat guys in sleighs. No, it's called Christmas. Christmas. And it's so important for us to understand why this time of year is the best time of the year. And honestly, it's a strategic time of year for us to make God known. So let's get started. We're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 1, starting at verse 18. Matthew chapter 1, starting at verse 18. This is how Jesus the Messiah was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. So a couple of things here. In the Jewish culture, they took engagement incredibly seriously. In fact, once you got engaged, you were legally married. The only way that you could break off an engagement was through divorce. So once they had betrothed themselves together, they were considered married in every legal way. They had just not come together and consummated the relationship. It says that before the actual ceremony occurred, while she was still a virgin. Now, how many of you guys have ever come up with a really good plan? And I mean, you had the plan, you had it figured out, steps A through Z, everything made sense, all of your ducks were in a row, you knew exactly how things were going to happen, when they were going to happen, the way they were going to happen, everything was lined up, and then that plan got shattered. Anybody in here ever had one of those happen to you before? Yeah, it happens to me all the time. Just about every Sunday morning, actually. This is exactly what happens to Joseph and Mary. They've got a plan. And here's the thing. It's a good plan. It's actually a God-honoring plan. They're doing this God's way. They've waited. They've gotten engaged. They're going to get married. And then they're going to have a baby. But then all of a sudden, Mary shows up pregnant. And this is an unwanted surprise for them. Now, Mary knew it was coming. We're going to talk about her next week. But for Joseph, this was a complete shock. But there's a reason why the Bible tells us that she was still a virgin. So as you read your Bible, and you should be reading your Bible because you can't actually be a Christian without reading your Bible. You can get saved, but you're not going to be Christian without the Word of God. Amen? Amen? So as you read your Bible, you need to learn how to pay attention to the details. Human beings wrote the Bible, but they were inspired fully by God. God gave them the words to put to paper. So words have meaning. Words have importance. So this word that gets thrown in here, it says that while she was still a virgin, that detail matters greatly to the story. Well, why does it matter? Well, let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 21. It says, "So you see, just as death came into the world through a man," all you ladies are like, "Yeah, I knew that." "Now, the resurrection from the dead has begun through another man. Just as everyone dies because we all belong to Adam, everyone who belongs to Christ will be given new life. But there is an order to this resurrection. Christ was raised at the first of the harvest, then all who belong to Christ will be raised when he comes back." So the first human being was Adam. You guys know the story, Adam and Eve in the garden. God took the materials of the earth and he shaped them into a form, and then he breathed life into Adam. Adam did not have human parents. What this meant, though, was that Adam was a living being that had free will. You guys know the story. Adam and Eve rebelled against God. They did their own thing. They ate of the fruit that they weren't supposed to. And Adam and Eve brought sin into the world. Well, now we live in a fallen and broken world where there is sickness and there's death, there's pain and there's suffering, and there are all of these consequences to sin going on around us. Every single human being born as a descendant of Adam and Eve has been born with what we call a sinful nature. It is your natural tendency to give in to selfishness and to sin. It is your natural tendency to do things your own way, to go against God, and to rebel. This is problematic, and we see the evidence of this all around us. We see natural disasters, we have pandemics, we see people killing each other in the streets, all because of the consequence of human sin. So now, here comes Mary, and Mary becomes pregnant, but she becomes pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit. In 1 Corinthians 15:45, it says, "The scripture tells us the first Adam became a living person, but the last," or the second Adam, that is Christ, "is a life-giving spirit." Jesus is the second Adam. He is 100% human. His mother is a human being, but he's also 100% God because he's conceived by the Holy Spirit. So he is what we would call the God-man. The reason that that is important is that because Jesus is 100% human and 100% God, he does not carry the sinful nature. He is a second Adam, but he does still have complete free will. He can sin, he can rebel, but he doesn't have that nature that all of us have because only one of his parents are human. Do you guys understand that? You tracking with me? All right. In John chapter 3:16, it says, "For this is how God loved the world. He gave his one and only Son so that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." Now, if you're a King James Version fan, and some of you are, the one and only there, he's also an Elizabethan scholar. So it's very, very impressive. The language there, one and only, in the King James is only begotten. Well, this phraseology has actually confused people over the years. Entire cults have developed out of a misunderstanding of what only begotten or one and only means. So how many of you guys are familiar with the Jehovah's Witnesses, right? Well, the Jehovah's Witnesses believe that Jesus is created. He is a creature created by God. And the reason they arrived there is a misunderstanding of this verse. All throughout church history, there have been misunderstandings because people think that this means that Jesus was created by God. But that's not what this is saying. The verse, the word in the original Greek simply means unique, one of a kind, the only type like it. And that's what it's saying about Jesus. Jesus is the only child of God because he is God. He is eternal and he's always been with God. The rest of us, we're adopted. Jesus is the unique one and only. We're the stepkids. In Matthew chapter 1, verse 19, it says, "Joseph, to whom she was engaged, was a righteous man. and did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly. This is actually a pretty huge thing. In our day, divorce is kind of an easy thing. Statistically, very, very few people actually wait until they're married to begin having sex. So for us, it's kind of watered down. We're like, why is this such a big deal? To them, this was a huge deal. In fact, if you were a young woman and you were found not to be a virgin when you got married, you could actually be stoned. If you committed adultery, the punishment for adultery in that culture was stoning. Now, it wasn't actually still practiced in the time of Jesus, but there was a cultural stoning that would occur. In fact, if you did something like this, people would just shun you. They would basically kick you out of society. You wouldn't be welcome in the temple court. You wouldn't be welcomed at synagogue. You wouldn't be welcome to join the community. And good luck making a living. So basically, you'd have to uproot and go somewhere else to where nobody knew your story. And if you were a young woman, it was even worse for you. So imagine for Joseph what this is like. He's so excited, so full of expectation and anticipation, and he finds out that Mary is pregnant. And you can only imagine the thoughts that run through his head, right? Because he didn't have the Bible that we have to read. So he's thinking Mary has been unfaithful. Maybe with a guy in the community, maybe with a Roman soldier, who knows? But he's thinking that Mary has been fooling around on him. But Joseph is a righteous man. Righteous means that he did things right according to God's law. But this also shows us that he's a man of compassion. He's compassionate. He does not want her to be publicly humiliated. He does not want her life to be destroyed. But at the same time, he has to do the right thing and end the relationship because she has sinned. So he does the right thing in the best way with her benefit in mind. Can you think of a better person to raise the Son of God? Can you think of a better person for God to have chosen to be the overseer, the protector of his own Son, than this righteous man who lives a life full of compassion? In verse 20, it says, as he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Now, we see angels in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. Whenever an angel shows up in the Bible and they have something to say, you need to pay attention because it's a big deal. Joseph, son of David, the angel said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. So here we have this confirmation again that what is going on is not a human thing, it is a God thing. Well, the first thing that he says to Joseph is something we need to pay attention to. He calls him the son of David. Joseph is actually only the second person in the New Testament that gets called by this title. The reason that he calls him the son of David is because King David, if you remember back to our covenant series, King David had been promised by God that he would have a dynasty and that he would never fail to have someone related to him on the throne of Israel. So now it's been 600 years since there's been a king, but there's this expectation that a king is coming again. And so when Joseph gets called son of David, the angel is pointing something out. He's reminding Joseph of a promise that has been, that it's about to be fulfilled. And then he says, do not be afraid. Why would Joseph be afraid? I'd be afraid of marrying this girl. This was his plan anyway. Well, the reason that he'd be afraid is that the situation has changed a little bit now. Now she's pregnant. So even if they get married tomorrow, this baby's going to be super premature, right? People are going to notice that the time is not adding up. And you guys ever done that before? Where you're like, you'll meet somebody and they'll tell you how long they've been married and then how old their kids are. And you pause and you start doing the math in your head and they know exactly what you're doing, right? Because that's what we do. We're like, that's only 7.5 months. That doesn't seem right. This is what Joseph is going to face. But it's going to be in a culture where you will be shamed, humiliated, and exorcised for having done it. Because people are either going to assume that he got Mary pregnant or that somebody else got her pregnant. Either way, people are going to be whispering about him. People are going to be spreading rumors because they live in a small, tight-knit community. Everybody knows everybody's business. And for the rest of his life, Everybody's going to know his story. Not only that, it might affect his business. I mean, if you are a Jewish person in the first century, you want to go to righteous people to have them work on your house. He's a carpenter. He may starve as a result of this. But the angel says to him, do not be afraid. Guys, this applies directly to us. Because the same Jesus that was living inside of Mary is the same Jesus that's living inside of us. And when we make that decision to align ourselves with Christ, people are going to talk about it. And they're going to notice it. And sometimes we're going to stick out from them and we're going to look different from the culture and we're not going to think the same way of everybody else and we're going to get called all kinds of names. You're going to get called a bigot and you're going to get called a hater and you're going to get called all kinds of things because you don't agree with what the world has to say. But the Holy Spirit would say to us, do not be afraid. Just do what God has done, because what has been conceived in Mary is by the Holy Spirit. What has been born inside of you, you have been born again by the same Holy Spirit. So don't be afraid to live for Jesus. Verse 21 says, she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. The name Jesus is the Hebrew name Yeshua. It literally means the Lord saves. The Lord saves. Now, this was not an uncommon name in his time, but it was a very, very intentional name to give to this particular baby, because this baby has come for a purpose. This baby has come to save people from their sins. Not to save them from their debt, not to save them from marital issues, not to save them from consequences to other choices they made, to save them from their sin. Now, all the rest of those good things, those come along with it. But the reason Jesus came, do not miss this, the reason Jesus came was to save us from sin. Why sin? Because sin is the problem. Human sin is the issue in the world. Our choice to do things our own way, outside of God's will, that's what creates all of the issues in the world around us. You cannot point to a single negative thing in the world without it being the result or consequence of sin. Jesus came to fix that. In Genesis chapter 3:15, there's a promise given right after Adam and Eve screwed up. Right after they rebelled and sin entered into the world, God made a promise to Satan. And he said to Satan, I will cause hostility between you and the woman, between your offspring and her offspring. Now, the offspring of Satan are the angels that followed him in rebellion out of heaven. The offspring of Eve is humanity. And he says, but there's a specific one who's coming someday. He will strike your head, you will strike his heel. This is the first time the gospel is presented in the Bible. Genesis 3:15. And God says, guess what, Satan? You are going to cause problems for humanity. And there's going to be one that comes. And you're going to damage him, but he's going to destroy you. When the angel comes to Mary, or to Joseph, and says, you will give him the name Jesus because he will save his people, it was the fruition, it was the fulfillment of this promise. In Romans chapter 5, verse 14, it says, still, everyone died. From the time of Adam to the time of Moses, even those who did not disobey an explicit commandment of God as Adam did. Now, Adam is a symbol. He is a representation of Christ, who was yet to come. But there is a great difference between Adam's sin and God's gracious gift. For the sin of this one man, Adam, brought death to many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of forgiveness to many through this other man, Jesus Christ. The result of God's gracious gift is very different from the result of that one man's sin. Adam's sin led to condemnation. But God's free gift leads to our being made right with God, even though we are guilty of many sins. For the sin of this one man, Adam, caused death to rule over many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and his gift of righteousness for all who receive it and live in triumph over sin and death through this one man, Jesus Christ. What does it mean that Jesus saves? It means that what Jesus did on the cross makes it powerful for you to live a life of victory over the things that have always held you back. What Jesus did on the cross and his resurrection from the grave makes it possible for you not to be held down by your sin, not to be owned by your past decisions, and not to have to live perpetually in a state of brokenness and frustration. You can be saved. Yeah. And it's a free gift because Jesus paid the price. You don't have to do it for yourself. You don't have to jump through hoops. You just have to receive by faith. Jesus saves. This is the best news in the history of the world. Matthew chapter 22, Matthew 1, 22. All of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through the prophet. Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. So now Jesus has given a name, but now he's also given a title. And his title, Emmanuel, literally means God is with us. Well, the reason that this came about was about 700 years earlier, in the time of the prophet Isaiah, there was a king in Judah named Ahaz. Ahaz was freaking out because a couple of other kings were coming to fight against him. And he was afraid that he was going to be thrown out and another king was going to be put in his place. So he went to Isaiah and he began to plead to God to save him. So Isaiah comes and offers him this prophecy in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, 15. And the prophecy was basically this. There's going to be a virgin girl who's going to give birth. And by the time that baby gets to an age of understanding, your problems are going to have corrected themselves. I'm going to work it out on your behalf. So what we have here is a type or a foreshadowing. And the Bible does this a lot. You see, a lot of the Old Testament is given so that we can understand the New Testament better. Like the story of Abraham sacrificing his son Isaac. A lot of people are like, what was up with that? God just randomly said, hey, Abraham, you're 100 now. You finally have a kid. Now I want you to kill him and give him to me. People are like, that story makes no sense. Well, you have to remember that God said, no, you don't have to. I will provide the sacrifice. The story of Abraham and Isaac was a type. It was a symbol, a foreshadowing of what God planned to do through Jesus. Here again, with this virgin girl being said that she's going to have a baby, this was something that happened in history, but it was also a foreshadowing of something that God was going to do through Jesus. And the reason why it matters so much in the New Testament is because the virgin birth of Jesus makes it possible for our sins to be saved because God is with us. We use this terminology all the time. Around Christmas time, we see it on billboards, we see it on coffee mugs, we see it on t-shirts. I mean, anywhere you go to a church or a Christian place, you're going to see Emmanuel, God is with us. It's a nice little slogan, right? God is with me. If he is for me, nobody can be against me. And like, we get this stuff in our heads, but does it ever penetrate our hearts? Do we actually understand the significance and the value of what it means that God is with us? It means that you're not alone. It means that you don't have to figure it out by yourself. It means that you don't have to be strong enough to face up to what this world is bringing against you because God is with us. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 2. This is one of my favorite passages in the Bible. Starting at verse 14. Because God's children are human beings, this is talking about us, made of flesh and blood, the Son also became flesh and blood. This passage is going to explain to you in detail why Jesus had to give up heaven to become a human being. For only as a human being could he die. And only by dying could he break the power of the devil, who had the power of death. You notice the word had there? That's past tense. Yeah. Only in this way could he set free, say set free, all who have lived their lives as slaves to fear of dying. We also know that the Son did not come to help the angels. He came to help the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, it was necessary for him to be made in every respect like us, his brothers and sisters, so that he could be our merciful and faithful high priest before God. Then he could offer a sacrifice that would take away the sins of the people. Since he himself has gone through suffering and testing, he is able to help us when we are being tested. The reason Jesus gave up heaven to become human was because that was the only way we could be saved. All of the sacrifices combined of the Old Testament did nothing to wipe away human sin. All they did was cover it up, cover it up, cover it up. How many of you know that if you keep covering up the dirt, one of these days the rug's not going to be big enough to hold it? Well, that's what happens in humanity. As the dirt comes spilling out around the edges, and we live in this perpetual state of brokenness and pain and suffering. Just did a funeral yesterday for a 42-year-old woman. Died of cirrhosis of the liver. Talk about brokenness for her family and her friends. Why? That's always the question, right? Why, God? The week before that, I had to do a funeral for a stillborn baby. That really makes us ask that question. Why, God? Why? It hurts. It hurts. The reason that it hurts is because we know instinctually that it's not supposed to be that way. But then we misplace our aggression. We get mad at God and we say, God, why did you do this? And the answer is he didn't. He gave it to us perfect. And then our sin messed it up. But he loves us so much that in the midst of this brokenness and this confusion and this mess that we've caused, Jesus says, no, 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 I'll go out there and I'll clean it up myself. I'm not going to show them how to do it. I'm going to do it myself. I'm going to become like them so I can die in their place so that they can know heaven again. I love what it says here at the end. Since Jesus himself has gone through suffering and testing, he is able to help us when we are being tested. Do I have any nerds in the house? Any nerds? 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 Not geeks. I don't understand you guys. I'm saying nerds, like people that love to learn, people that love to read, people that spent more time in the library than on dates in college. That was me all day long, right? All right, so I am a nerd. But sometimes being a nerd has its benefits. Like in high school, and please forgive me, I recognize that we have a representative of higher education, so you got to forgive me for what I'm about to say, okay, brother? I used to sell all of my tests and papers in high school, and I made a lot of money. And at the end of the year, and people knew I was a straight-A student. That's just who I was. I worked really hard. People knew that at the end of the year that they could buy my stuff. And our teachers were pretty lazy, so they would just reuse the same stuff and not ever change anything. So if they got my stuff, they would be able to get an A without even trying the next year. Now, they had to spend a lot of money to get these. Like one math class, I think I sold it for like $200. Made a kid get it for $200 for all my tests. Yeah, it was great for me, right? Why in the world would somebody have paid $200 to me for all my math tests? Because they knew I had been there, done that, and had the T-shirt. And then if they did it my way, they were going to pass and get really good grades. Jesus came to earth as a human, did this whole thing perfectly, and now says, here, I'll give you the answer. Yeah. You know what the answer is? It's Jesus. Yeah. He gives us the answer to all the tests, to everything that we're going to face, because he's been there and done it on our behalf. In Hebrews chapter 4:14, it says, so then, since we have a great high priest who has entered heaven, because Jesus didn't stay on earth, did he? He didn't stay here in his human form. He died and was resurrected into a perfect bodily form. He's still the God-man, fully human and fully God, but he didn't stay here. He went back to heaven. Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to what we believe. There's a reason it says hold firmly. Because if you hold to it loosely, the world's going to jerk it out of your hands. If you hold on to your faith nonchalantly, like this is just kind of a hobby for you, this is just kind of something, this is an app that you're adding on to the phone of your life, this is just something that you kind of do because grandma did it, you're not going to do it well. Because Christianity is all or nothing. Because Jesus says, I gave you everything, I expect the same thing in return. I think that's fair, right? This high priest of ours understands our weaknesses. For he faced all of the same testings that we did, yet he did not sin. We live in a culture today that really values empathy. And what does empathy say? Empathy says that I'm going to sympathize with you where you are at. But when we really value empathy is when someone else has been there and done that, right? Have you ever met somebody when you were dieting and they're like, I just can't gain any weight. I try so hard. I eat cookie. I just eat whatever I want anytime and I just can't gain a pound. And you're just sitting there like, the world's smallest violin, you know, like, shut up. That is not a problem for most people. I'm not going to that person to talk to them about losing weight. I'm going to go talk to somebody that knows the struggle, who's yo-yoed back and forth, who's cried into their cup of Oreos and milk, right? I want the person who's been there and done that, but did well. Jesus has done it. He has been tested and tempted in every way that you will ever be tested and tempted. And you know what? You might think, come on now. Jesus was God. Yeah, well, he spent 40 days alone in the wilderness with Satan. Until that's your experience, Jesus wins. Okay? But yet he did not sin. So who are you going to go to? You're gonna go to the people in elected office to give you the answers? Good luck. You're going to go to your friends? I mean, most of us, I love my friends, but we're all a mess. Who are you going to go to? Who are you going to go to show you the way to do it the right way? You're going to go to Jesus because he's been here and he did it perfectly. So let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy and we will find grace to help us when we need it the most. You can come boldly to the throne of God and you can say anything. And guys, you can get down into the gutter of honesty with Jesus. And you can share with him those wicked, disgusting, nasty thoughts or things that you've done. And he's going to go, yeah, I've been tempted with that too. I get it. Here's help. Here's my spirit to strengthen you. Here's how to resist. Here's how to say no. Here's how to get back on track when you've screwed up and you've messed up. Because Jesus did not sin, but he's been tested in every way. So you can come boldly to God and you can just let it out. You don't have to hold it back. You don't have to try to hide it. You don't have to try to cover some of it up because it's too gross for God. Jesus gets it. And you know what? He's already handled it on the cross. Because when he was on the cross, it was all poured out on him anyway. So everything you've ever done wrong, he's already experienced intimately. So you might as well confess it so that it can be washed away. Amen? In Matthew chapter 1, 24, it says, when Jesus woke up, he did as the angel commanded, and he took Mary as his wife. But he did not have sexual relations with her until the son was born. And Joseph named him the Lord Saves. To me, this is the most powerful part of the story. Because Joseph is obedient. But he's obedient purely in faith. Because, now I don't want to get too biology on us, but hang with me for a second. All of the evidence of whether or not Mary was actually a virgin is about to be destroyed when she has her baby, right? So he's taking this 100% by faith that he's hearing from God. But his decision is to take responsibility for the proclamation that has been made to him. You see, the angel came and told him, this son of yours is going to save the world of their sin. This son of yours is God with us. And Joseph's response is, okay, he's mine. I'm going to take responsibility. I'm going to raise him. I'm going to provide for him. I'm going to work for him. I'm going to serve by helping him to grow up. I'm going to teach him all the good that I know. I'm going to connect him as much as I can to his real father. And I'm going to give my life to this baby because this is God with us. Well, this morning, you've also been given a proclamation. This morning, you've heard the reality that God is with us. So what are you going to do with it? If that's not your current reality, if you don't know Jesus, then you need to be saved. And Jesus will gladly save you this morning. You just have to ask him. But if you've already been saved, then it has to become your mission to make it known this week, to make it known each and every day that God is with us. Because guys, the lights are on the houses, but it's dark inside. Does that make sense to you? There's a lot of people who are walking around with smiling faces, and it's the best time of the year, but they're dying on the inside because God isn't with them, and they don't know that he can be. Let me ask you one final question. Do you believe that there's any other answer that the world needs? Do you believe that there's any other answer that the world needs? I don't want to beat a dead horse, but I'll use this illustration. If tomorrow a company came out with a pill that eliminated COVID-19, every single one of you in this room would be calling everybody that you knew to tell them because we want this crap to be over. I use that word, yeah. The Bible uses a worse word for sin. I think you would agree with me that we want the brokenness and the hurt, the pain, the suffering to be over in this world. You agree with that? Yeah. We want it to be done. Well, you know what? There's a way for us to fight back against it. There's a way for us to push back the gates of hell. God is with us. But we can't keep that knowledge to ourselves. We have to proclaim the name. Would you bow your heads this morning? If you're here today and you want Jesus to save you, you want Jesus to forgive your sins, and you want to start a new life with him, I'm going to lead you in a prayer. It's a prayer of salvation. And you make these your words, and you will be saved. Jesus, I have sinned by rebelling against your word and truth. Please forgive me and wash me clean in your blood. I believe you lived a perfect life, died on the cross for my sins, were resurrected from the dead, and will someday return in glory. I surrender full control of my life to you. I freely confess Jesus is Lord. For the rest of us, I'm going to pray that the Holy Spirit gives you a boldness that you cannot shake this entire month of December. I'm going to pray that everywhere you go, every conversation you have, every interaction you come across, that the Holy Spirit just begins welling up and coming out of your mouth to where you begin to proclaim the truth of Jesus, that God is with us. Because that's what the world needs. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would send your Spirit in a fresh anointing. Lord, that you would fall upon this place, that you would shake us out of our apathy, shake us out of our laziness, shake us out of our fear, whatever it is that's holding us back. And I pray this morning that your word would come alive. And that we would realize that God with us is not just a nice saying, it is the most important